Good afternoon, New York, and the rest of our listeners around the globe. My name is June Stoyer, and I'm the host of the Organic View Radio Show. Our podcast is available on iTunes, Zune, and you can also visit our website at www.theorganicview.com. If you'd like to be on the show or would like to find out about sponsorship opportunities, please contact us at questions@theorganicview.com. Today's show is sponsored by the City of Sevierville, the East Coast's hottest, most affordable eco-travel destination for families, couples, and holiday weekends. If you want to relax, reconnect with nature, and have the time of your life, please check out visitsevierville.com. For more promotional offers, please visit our website at www.theorganicview.com. Also, don't forget to check out our contest section on our website for your chance to win one of our cool prizes. For more information, please visit www.theorganicview.com/contests. Memories are a priceless treasure that will last forever if they are shared. Our country's history must be preserved if younger generations are to learn and grow. On today's show, Vietnam War veteran Mr. Don Campbell will be my guest to talk about an amazing collection of memorabilia at the Tennessee Aviation Museum in beautiful Sevierville. So I'd like to welcome to the show Mr. Don Campbell.
Thank you.
Mr. Campbell, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and also about your service to our great country?
Well, I'm I was born and raised in southwestern Ohio on a farm. Parents were modest means. Was good enough in baseball to get a scholarship to the local university, attended Air Force ROTC there, and entered the Air Force as a pilot in 1958. Served 21 years in the Air Force as a pilot and also as an educator, teacher, and had 1 year of combat in Vietnam in 1969. 21 years, I retired from the Air Force and taught high school out in Las Vegas. In fact, taught Air Force Junior ROTC for 12 years. Moved back to the old family farm in Ohio for a few years, and it was a little bit chilly. So my wife is from Eastern Tennessee, and she talked me into coming down here and looking at the area. And we moved down here in 1994 and have been down here ever since, and just love it.
Thank you. Can you talk about the Tennessee Aviation Museum? Why was it created?
Well, I think it was probably Neil's idea. He, for several years, collected warbirds. And I speak of Neil. I'm talking to Neil Melton, the museum owner and airplane owner. And he actually was able to retire fairly early due to some very hard work in the theater and entertainment industry. And he had several warbirds in storage in the local area. And at some point, I think in the late 90s, Neil and his wife Rhonda decided to share their remarkable warbird collection with the public. And after a couple of years of construction, the Tennessee Museum of Aviation opened in 2001.
What are some of the exhibits that you enjoy the most?
Well, I think probably the airplanes is what I enjoy the most. Of course, we have a lot of exhibits that explore early aviation history that are on display inside the museum exhibit area. We have artifacts from early aviation, WW1, WW2, the Korean War, and Vietnam. But when it comes to some of my favorites, I enjoy the airplanes most of all. We've got several flying airplanes. We've got two P-47 Thunderbolts from World War II that fly and do air shows and reunions and other aviation-related activities. And we've got a very special airplane in an A-1 Sky Raider from Korea and Vietnam. It is actually one of the two remaining A-1Hs that actually fly, so it's very, very rare. Neil flies at several air shows and reunions. In fact, we had a reunion here not too long ago in early May where some of the A-1 pilots that flew our particular Sky Raider, its number is 665, they flew it in the Vietnam War, and the so-called secret war that went on over in Laos and Cambodia that not a lot of people knew about. But they flew it there, and when Neil put on some demonstrations and made low passes with it, you could see some tears start to well up in some of the eyes. So I think the Sky Raider is probably my favorite exhibit in the museum.
How does it feel as a veteran to look at these planes, to see them function again, especially when Neil takes them up in the air?
Well, I've always loved airplanes, especially older World War One and Two airplanes. I love the sounds of their engines. I love to watch them make low passes in front of a crowd. It just does something to you as a pilot. Even though I flew jets during my career, I can still relate with some of those aviators from the past. It's just a real thrill for me to be able to be associated with the museum and play with these airplanes and get to do some of the things and participate in the local air shows that we do here. Have a really good time.
When other veterans come to visit, what are some of their responses?
Oh, you know, the veterans are the ones that I really like to show around and tour in the museum. We get guys from World War II, even though they're in their 90s, and then, of course, veterans from Korea and Vietnam. They show a lot of interest. Some of them have even participated with some of the different types of airplanes that we have on display, and it brings back a lot of memories and stories. They'll tell stories that, just sit there spellbound listening to them. It's one of the really nice parts of being a tour guide and showing people around the museum is to relate with these veterans and hear their stories. We're losing a lot of the WW2 guys. There's not too many of them around, but we still get a few of them in. And, of course, we got two P-47 Thunderbolts that served during World War II, and some of them worked on these airplanes. And periodically, we've had an older pilot that actually flew the Thunderbolts during WW2, and I enjoy the veterans. Of course, being a veteran myself, I can relate.
Could you share with our listeners one of the stories that just struck you the most?
Well, a lot of things happen at the museum as people come and go. We do a lot of tours for high schools, junior high schools, and I think one of the most touching things that I've had happen to me out there was a Bible school class of kids from around 6 to 9. And last summer, I was touring a group of these kids around. And at the end of the tour, this shy little girl came up. She was probably 7 or 8 years old. She came up to me and asked if I was a veteran. And I said, yes. And then she asked, did you fight in a war? And I said, yes, since I had served in Vietnam. And this little kid hugged my leg, and then she said in a very small voice, thank you. And boy, if that wasn't touching, that kind of got to me that day. But I enjoy those little kids and enjoy the senior citizen groups, the high school groups. Sometimes our generation that is in high school right now don't show an awful lot of interest in the past, which kind of bothers me to a little bit, but we do everything we can at the museum to get them interested in the past and what happened to keep our country free. There's a lot of people that have served for freedom, and as future generations, we've got to maintain a strong military. Personally, I don't see world peace happening in the future, and we may be required to make some sacrifices in the name of freedom as we continue.
When it comes to preserving history for these future generations, what do you hope that parents and young people that are listening can learn from visiting the museum, as well as even just connecting with you directly and learning about our history?
Well, I think one of the things that the museum does for anybody that comes to see it is maybe for the first time a lot of these younger generation type individuals are being exposed to, you know, actually see and touch things from the past that have been involved to keep our freedom. And they may learn a little bit about it in school and history. They may be on the internet, maybe watching a documentary once in a while or something like that. But it's still really tough to relate actually what was involved as far as some of our exhibits go. We've got airplanes that were actually there. We've got memorabilia and exhibits in our exhibit halls that actually show aviation step back in time, and they can actually see, view, and in some places touch it, and hopefully they can relate a little bit more to what happened back then, so that we may walk around in a free country where they may not have had the opportunity to see something like this before. And so hopefully, you know, we do some good in that respect.
You have quite a collection of memorabilia that recognizes the bravery of Brigadier General James H. Doolittle. Could you share with our listeners, especially our younger listeners who are not familiar with him, why this collection is so incredibly important for our history's preservation?
Well, kids today kind of have a little trouble relating with Pearl Harbor, but December 7, 1941, when the Japanese attacked us in Hawaii at Pearl Harbor, and we were devastated, and of course the country was very depressed at the time. And 6 months later, after several months of training, Jimmy Doolittle and some other pilots were able to proceed on a aircraft carrier named the Hornet out into the Pacific towards Japan to try and make a secret a low-level bombing mission against Japan. In April, they launched these airplanes, B-25s, off of the aircraft carrier, the Hornet, in bad weather conditions, and it was a one-way type mission where they would have to land in China if everything went well. And they made it off. They went over Japan. They dropped a few bombs. They had to launch a little early because they were detected, so most of them ran out of gas and either crash-landed in China. A couple went down in the Russian peninsula over there, and several of them went down in the sea. And even though the bomb damage that they did to the country of Japan was not very extensive, it did a lot for the morale of the American people back in our country, who were, you know, somewhat down after we were bombed in Hawaii. But now we had responded. Jimmy Doolittle led this raid. He became a hero, and it really excited the people in America to get behind the war effort. And, you know, a lot of people were being drafted. Women went to work in aircraft factories and other factories to support the war. And Jimmy Doolittle was a hero and the leader of that mission. So he's one of the great guys from WW2. We lost him a few years ago, but there are still a couple of the Doolittle Raiders that are still living. They're, of course, are heroes to everybody, especially in our generation.
You have quite a collection at the museum that is devoted to his honor. Could you share with our listeners about some of the collection?
Well, we do have a replica of his Medal of Honor. We've got a nice photo of Jimmy Doolittle that is also signed by many of the members that went on that mission. We've got a really nice model of a B-25. It was the aircraft that he flew off of the carrier of the Hornet, and this is all in a special display area, kind of in the middle. It's one of the highlights of the museum.
There's also another display about the four chaplains that I personally thought was just amazing. Can you share with our listeners a little bit about this exhibit?
Well, this is probably something that most Americans don't know about, but with most military units that went into combat, we did have chaplains, religious people that went with the troops, held services, and of course they were there in combat and did help with the medics, and also if a person was fatally wounded, we'd give last rites and comfort them as much as possible. And we have a lot of chaplain material that was used, even down to a small portable organ that is kind of folded up. It can be extended, and like to have a Sunday service, these guys could set up out in the front lines with the troops. They got the material for communions, and these chaplains, they served on the front lines, and they were a very vital part of the American military. And we've got some really nice displays of the chaplain stuff in our museum.
Women also played a very big role in all the wars, as you've mentioned previously. Can you talk about some of the memorabilia that recognizes the contribution that women have made?
Well, we've got some great displays of what women have done in our museum, and of course the ones that I'm really quite interested in. They didn't fly combat in any of our wars, but they served as transport pilots. They would ferry airplanes from the factories after the airplanes were assembled and built, test the airplanes a bit, fly them forwarding stages so they could be used in combat. They don't get the recognition that they really deserve, but actually women were a very, very vital part of WW2 and Korean and Vietnam. And of course now, as you know, and most of our listeners out there would know, that women have equal rights with anybody flying in the military. They fly fighters, they fly for the Thunderbirds or demonstration team. But besides the women that flew, the women that worked in the factories and built the tanks, the jeeps, and the airplanes, they did a lot for the war effort during WW2 and later. Very, very proud of them.
The museum has such an amazing collection of different types of memorabilia. Where were these collections obtained, and how long did it take to build up this collection?
Well, I think probably when the word got out that Neil and Rhonda were going to establish a Tennessee Museum of Aviation, there are hundreds of people out there that have items relating to either their service, their grandparents' service, their great-grandparents' service, and they've been laying around their house, maybe in storage, for years and years and years. We have numerous items. Almost all the items are donated, and some of them are on loan where, you know, a person will loan it to us for display, and they may want to have it back later. All the items are donated and loaned to us. And they come from individuals once in a while, from an industry or a factory that built things that were related to aviation during the war. You would be amazed, and it's constant today, where people will bring stuff in and donate it to the museum. I'm sure we've got a good supply in some of our storage areas of items that, you know, are waiting to be displayed. And that's one of the nice things about our museum. The exhibits do change periodically. So, like, if you visited 2 years ago and you came back today, you may see some items on display that weren't there 2 years ago when you were there. Most of them are from individuals and from companies. And in fact, I've donated some things from my service. Most of volunteers who are senior citizens and have prior military service have some stuff stuck in their closet that they donated to the museum. You'd be amazed at the amount of stuff is out there.
For me, when I visited the museum, I was particularly struck by the Korean display. My late father had served in the Korean War, and it was a subject that he never spoke about. To have the opportunity to see something that my dad had experienced was really profound for me. The fact that you have so many different types of items that veterans and their families can view and know that it's preserved is really just so incredibly important. So I just want to acknowledge that. Another display that you feature is the Norden bomb site. Could you share with our listeners exactly why this was so important during World War II?
Well, the Norden bomb site was an invention by the U.S. Before the Norden bomb site came along, it was hard to get accurate bombing from our bombers because the B-17 and B-24s during World War II would have to fly at a high altitude. To be accurate, you needed some kind of a sighting device to put your bombs on target. And the Norden bomb site was invented during World War II, and it came in where we had a bombardier in each of the major bombers, and as they would cross into enemy territory, they could use this bomb site for very accurate bombing. It would take into account the wind directions and how many airplanes were in the formation, and it got to the point where the Norden bomb site was one of the things during World War II that was invented that probably hastened the war, made it a little shorter. And we've got one of them in our museum. And it was used on mostly B-17 and B-24s during WW2 and used in both the European theater and in the Pacific theater.
One of the amazing things that I found about the museum was the opportunity to actually go inside some of the planes. Can you share with our listeners some of the details about some of the planes that are featured and why it's important that some of these planes are still left operable?
Well, one of the key things that we have at our museum is where the kids or anybody that actually can fit into an A4 jet cockpit. This is a Navy fighter, and we have a cockpit of an A4 that you can climb into, sit down in the seat, move the stick around like you were flying the airplane, push the throttle up to where you would go 500-600 miles an hour, look at all the switches that the pilots had to deal with. It's got the gun sight on it where it was electrical, and of course we don't have electricity hooked up, but where you could show the individual sitting in the seat where a little dot would appear. He could maneuver the stick around. On the top of the stick was a little trigger where he could get behind the bad guy and show him how combat was actually flowing. And kids especially just eat this up. In fact, last summer I toured a guy that was 94 years old, and he was able to climb into that cockpit. We got some pictures of him. He was able to see what it was like even at the age of 94, but that is great attraction for young people. And of course the other airplanes that fly, people or individuals don't actually sit in those, but they get to see them up close, and if they happen to be there on the right day, one of our airplanes may be out on the ramp running up, or may be doing a check flight after an annual inspection or something like that. So besides the A4 cockpit where you can sit in, there's a possibility if you happen to be there on the right day, you could see one of our warbirds flying.
I also thought it was kind of interesting to see one of the helicopters, the rescue copters, where you could see the actual bullet holes still intact.
Yes, we got an H-43 that actually used in Vietnam. It was one of what we call the war curses over there, where it was used a lot. And it does have some bullet holes in it that are, you can actually see, and you can see other little patches where patches have been made over bullet holes. And if you could get down and look underneath it, there are several more bullet holes where it was being shot at, of course, from the ground, and it was in the air, so the bullet holes are in the bottom. But we've left it in that kind of condition so a person can actually see what a helicopter went through during the Vietnam War when it was exposed to hostile fire. Pretty interesting.
Mr. Campbell, can you talk about the wind tunnel fan? I thought that was also quite an amazing exhibit.
Well, yeah, we were actually able to obtain some of the big blades from a wind tunnel. And, of course, wind tunnels, most people realize, were used to simulate air rushing over an aircraft or even an automobile. And so you could learn a lot from a particular airplane by blowing air over it. But some of these wind tunnels were huge. And as you may remember, just looking at the fans, and those fans that were just half the entire wooden propeller, it's amazing how these things would operate, blow wind over it, and you could tell airplane was working in the air. You could move the controls around, and rather than testing it with a pilot in it, you could test it inside of a wind tunnel and get a lot of information on how it was going to react. And we were lucky enough to get some of these huge fans from a wind tunnel.
Another feature is a mock mess hall. I thought that was really, really interesting. It gives you the feeling of what the mess hall was like. Why is that something that was important for the museum to put up?
That mess hall was actually just down the road at another place in Tennessee, and was actually used during World War II to serve the troops meals. And it was being torn down, and it looked like it was going to be disposed of. And Neil and some of the volunteers were actually able to go down, disassemble this particular mess hall, and then bring it back, put part of it up in the museum, and then an artist did a drawing in the background to show people actually in it. And so you got to get the feeling from looking at the outside of this front of the missile that you were actually there during World War II getting ready to have a meal. And it's just another part of what went on when we were at war. And this is one of the ways that we show that the troops were fed and well taken care of.
Well, I think it's important, especially for younger people that perhaps might eat alone or, I mean, this day and age where people are not even eating together as families, to understand how people work together as a team, especially when facing some very, very difficult enemies.
Yes, in fact, you know, being in a fighter squadron in Vietnam, the camaraderie that you develop with your fellows that are doing the same thing, and of course during World War II, Korea and Vietnam, people were exposed to hostile fire a lot. And so, you know, the people that you worked with and you fought with, you ate with and you prayed with every day, these people became really, really good friends. And even today, there are squadron reunions and organizations that get together from WW2, from Korea and Vietnam. I belong to a couple groups that we have reunions periodically, and you develop a bond with your buddies from that era. And I think it was primarily because of some of the dangers that you faced. You were away from home and you were with some friends. This bond continues even after you get out of the service, and it's great to get together with some of the old guys from 1969, just get together and chat, talk about old times. That'll probably go on forever.
Well, I certainly hope so, and I certainly hope that more people, especially families and teachers, visit the museum and visit you for that matter.
So as we all consider the future, we've got to remember those that have fallen in the past and what they did for us. We have a lot of those items at our museum, airplanes and exhibits, and we kind of think it's one of the gems in the Smoky Mountains, and we're always glad to show people around, and we're very proud of it.
Mr. Campbell, I just want to say thank you so much for taking the time to be on the show today, and more importantly, thank you for your service to our country.
Well, thank you, and I was glad to do it for you.
And folks, please visit the Tennessee Museum of Aviation. Their website is www.tnairmuseum.com. And the information, along with a lot of pictures that I personally took while visiting the museum, will be available on theorganicview.com in the companion article with this interview, as well as in our photo section on the website, which is available at the top of the website. Once again, thank you for being on the show, sir. And folks, thank you so much for tuning in. This has been June Stoyer with the Organic View Radio Show. Have a great afternoon, everyone.